This first angel seems to be urging people to make up their minds because the hour of his judgment has come. It seems to be the end of things, a time of decision. Make up your minds about the good news. What's the content of this good news? According to Romans 1, 16 and 17, I think two of the most important verses in the Bible, and reflecting what we discussed this morning, what is the subject of the good news of which Paul was so proud? For I am not ashamed of the gospel, the good news, Paul wrote. It is the power of God for salvation to everyone who has faith, to the Jew first and also to the Greek. How does this good news have such power? What's in the good news that has power to heal and save people if it wins them back to faith? For in it something is revealed. The righteousness of God is revealed. But why would there be any need to reveal the righteousness of God? I mean, of course God is righteous. Even the little children know that. Has there ever been any doubt or question about the righteousness of God? Has anyone ever had the nerve, the impudence, the arrogance to suggest in the hearing of the universe that God is not righteous? And that brings up the whole subject of the great controversy. What do you understand to be the one great central issue in the great controversy between good and evil, Christ and Satan? When it began up in the beginning, what was the issue? What did the angels debate and discuss and argue about? Did they argue about which day was the Sabbath? Did they argue about tithing? Or diet? Or dress? Or recreation? Or maybe the length of angel skirts and hair and so forth, and things over which we often get exercised and about which we should indeed show good judgment and good taste? What were they arguing about? Something that almost split the universe asunder. And if God had not acted forthwith, it could have resulted. A great rift enough exists throughout God's universe. One third of the angels deciding against him. What was the issue? Was not the only question about God? What kind of a person is our God? And what does he want of his people? And the loyal angel said, he's an infinitely powerful, but equally gracious person. And we can sense that he values nothing higher than our freedom and our dignity and our individuality, that our love, our cooperation, our worship, our obedience may be freely given. Everything that God has asked us to do makes such good sense, we feel perfectly free as we obey him. He is worthy of our faith and love. And so the loyal angels reasoned with the ones who were wandering, and Christ led them, and the Holy Spirit of truth led in this teaching and this persuading that went on long before we were created. But the disloyal angels, led by the aggrieved adversary, maintained that God, on the contrary, was a harsh, demanding tyrant who enjoyed laying arbitrary requirements upon his people just to test their obedience and show his authority. He cannot be trusted. As he's described in Revelation 12, the devil has been a deceiver and a serpent. Jesus himself, who used such words sparingly, in John 8:44, called that other covering cherub who used to stand side by side with him, beside the Eternal One. Jesus called him now a liar and the father of lies. And Satan's lies have primarily been about God. In fact, as the great controversy was extended subsequently to this earth, Satan immediately accused God of lying. And you don't have faith in a liar, do you? We'd better not. He can't be trusted. Satan said to Eve that God had lied to her. You won't die, he said. It's not true. I've disobeyed and I've not died. He poured scorn on God and mocked him and misrepresented him as a selfish liar. And who would worship a God who's a selfish liar? Now, what has God done to meet these accusations and charges and clear up misunderstanding throughout his universe? One way would have been to let Adam and Eve die when they sinned. And that would have proved the truthfulness of his words. He could have said, Satan accuses me of lying when I say they will die. Well, if they had died, could anyone have gone on accusing God of lying? In fact, Ellen White mentions in Patriarchs and Prophets, in Desire of Ages and elsewhere, that if God had allowed Satan and his rebellious associates to reap the natural consequences of their rebellion way back in the beginning, they would have died. But the universe, never having seen death, would have assumed that God had executed them, and they would have served God from fear. And that is absolutely unacceptable to our gracious, intelligent God. And so instead of destroying, or instead of allowing them just to reap the natural consequences, as it's phrased, of their sin, God took his case into court, as mentioned in Romans 3:4. And I like the translation that reflects one of the forms of the Greek that suggests that obviously nobody could drag God into court. Unless God took his own case into court, it would never get there. And it can be translated, God, may you win your case when you take it into court. Now, when God took his case into court, on what basis could he expect to win in the eyes of the whole onlooking universe? And as we know, he has already won. When Jesus went back to heaven on Crucifixion Sunday, he said to the heavenly council, was it enough? And they bowed their heads and said, it was more than enough. Now, how did he convince them? Did God have to bribe the jury, terrify them with threats if they didn't agree with him? What picture do we have of God? Knowing the method that he used, what does it say about God? To use Ellen White's words, God never asks us to believe anything for which he does not provide adequate evidence, and it is evidence that appeals to the reason. That's the way he treats us. God, who could force us to agree, could terrify us into agreement, will never resort to that. He seeks to persuade. He wants us to agree with him freely because that's the direction in which the weight of evidence points. Think what that says about God and the nature of his kingdom into which he invites us to live. And so when God took his case into court, he must have evidence. The great, clear weight of evidence must be on his side. Here was Satan accusing him of having lied about death being the consequence of sin, and accusing him of being a selfish, arbitrary, demanding tyrant. What evidence did God take into court, and he thereby won his case?